learned that a vampire subculture existed in virtually every major city, as well as some smaller ones, such as Santa Cruz, California, Austin, Texas, Savannah, Georgia, Batavia, New York, and Des Moines, Iowa. A real vampire, he told me, is a person born with an extraordinary gift. He or she has the capacity to absorb, channel, transform, and manipulate pranic energy, which is the life force. Serious vampires are usually very spiritual. Well, how does drinking human blood fit in? I asked Peter Weston. Then I quickly added, if it does. Weston answered quietly, it is said that blood is the highest known source of pranic energy. If I drink your blood, then I take your strength.
My blood? I asked.
Yes, I would think you'd do nicely. I recall the nocturnal raid on the funeral parlor north of L.A. What about the blood of corpses? Those dead for a day or two? If a vampire, or poseur, were desperate, I suppose blood from a corpse would suffice. Let me tell you about real vampires, Detective. Most of them are needy, attention-seeking, and manipulative. They are frequently attractive, primarily because of their immortality, their forbidden desires, rebelliousness, power, eroticism, their sense of their own immortality.
You keep emphasizing the word real vampires. What distinction are you trying to make?
Most young people involved with the underground vampire lifestyle are merely role players. They are experimenting, looking for a group that meets their needs of the moment. There's even a popular mass market game, Vampire the Masquerade. Teenagers especially are attracted to the vampire lifestyle. Vampires have an incredible alternative way of looking at the world. Besides, vampires party late into the night, until the first light. His lips curled into a smile. Weston was definitely willing to talk to me, and I wondered why. I also wondered how seriously he took the vampire lifestyle. His clothing shop in town sold to young people looking for alternative trappings. Was he a poseur himself? Or was Peter Weston a real vampire? The mythology of the vampire goes back thousands of years, he told me. It's present in China, Africa, South and Central America, and Central Europe, of course. For a lot of people here in America, it's an aesthetic fetish. It's sexual, theatrical, and very romantic. It also transcends gender, which is an attractive idea these days. I felt it was time to stop his spiel and focus on the murders.
What about the murders? The actual violence taking place here in California and Nevada.
A mask of pain came over his face. I've heard Jeffrey Dahmer called a vampire cannibal. Also, Nicholas Clow, who you may not be familiar with. Clow was a Parisian mortician who confessed to murders in the mid-90s. Once he was captured, he took great pleasure in describing eating the flesh of corpses on his mortician slab. He became known all over Europe as the Vampire of Paris.
You've heard of Rod Ferrell in Florida, I asked.
Of course. He's a dark hero for some. Very big on the internet. He and his small cult bludgeoned to death the parents of another member. Then they carved numerous occult symbols into the dead bodies. I know all about Rod Ferrell. He was supposedly obsessed with opening the gates of hell. Thought he had to kill large numbers of people and consume their souls to be powerful enough to open up hell. Who knows? Maybe he succeeded, Weston said. He stared at me for a long moment. Let me tell you something, Detective Cross. This is the absolute truth. I believe it's important for you to understand. It's no more common for a vampire to be a psychopath or a killer than it is for any random person on the street.
I shrugged. I guess I'd have to check your research statistics on that one. In the meantime, one or more vampires, real ones or maybe just role players, have murdered at least a dozen people, I said. Weston looked a little sad.
Yes, Detective, I know.
That's why I consented to talk with you. I asked him one final question. Are you a vampire? Peter Weston paused before he answered. Yes, I am. The words cut through me. The man was completely serious. Chapter 28. That night in Santa Barbara, I was just a little more afraid of the dark than I had ever been before. I sat in my hotel room and read a touching novel called Waiting by Ha Jin. I was waiting as well. I called home twice that night. I wasn't sure if I was lonely or still feeling guilty about missing Damon's concert. Or maybe Peter Weston had frightened me with his vampire stories and books and the haunted look in his dark eyes. At any rate, I was taking vampires more seriously now that I had met him. Weston was a strange, eerie, unforgettable man. I had the feeling that I would meet or at least talk to him again. My fears didn't go away that night, and not even with the first light of morning shining brightly over the Santa Ynez Mountains. Something quite awful was happening. It involved twisted individuals, or maybe an underground cult. It probably had something to do with the vampire subculture, but maybe it didn't, and that was even more disturbing to think about. It would mean we were in a totally gray area with the investigation. By 7:30 in the morning, my rented sedan was easing into soupy fog, and then the morning traffic. I was singing a little Muddy Waters blues, which nicely matched my mood. I left Santa Barbara and headed toward Fresno. I had another expert to meet. I drove for a couple of hours. I got on 166 at Santa Maria and continued east through the Sierra Madres until I reached Route 99. I took it north. I was seeing California for the first time and liking most of what I saw. The topography was different than back east, and so were the colors. I fell into a comfortable driving rhythm. I listened to a Jill Scott CD. For long stretches of the road trip, I thought about the way my life had been going over the past couple of years. I knew that some of my friends were starting to worry about me, even my best friend, John Sampson, and I wouldn't exactly classify him as a worrier. Sampson had told me more than once that I was putting myself in harm's way. Sampson even suggested that maybe it was time for a career change. I knew I could go with the FBI, but that didn't seem like much of a change. I could also go back into psychiatry full-time, either see patients or possibly teach, maybe at Johns Hopkins, where I had gotten my degree and still had pretty good connections. Then there was Nana Mama's favorite tune. I needed to find someone and settle down again. I needed somebody to love. It wasn't as if I hadn't tried. My wife, Maria, had been killed in a drive-by shooting in D.C. that had never been solved. That happened when Damon and Janie were little, and I guess I never really got over it. Maybe I never would. Even now, if I let myself, I could get torn up thinking about Maria and what happened to her, to us, and how goddamn senseless it had been. What a terrible waste of a human life. It had left Damon and Janie without their mother. I tried hard to find someone, but maybe I just wasn't meant to be lucky twice in my lifetime. There had been Jesse Flanagan, but that couldn't have turned out worse. And then Christine Johnson, little Alex's mother. She was a teacher and now lived out here on the West Coast. She was doing well, loved Seattle, and had found someone. I still had terribly mixed feelings about Christine. She'd been hurt because of me. My fault, not hers. She had made it clear she couldn't live with a homicide detective. And then, not too long ago, I had started to become involved with an FBI agent named Betsy Cavalieri. Now Betsy was dead. Her murder remained unsolved. I was afraid to even have drinks with Jamila Hughes. The past was starting to haunt me. Some detective, I muttered, as I spotted the overhead sign, Fresno. I had come here to see a man about some teeth. Fangs, actually. Chapter 29. The Tattoo, Fang, and Claws Parlor was located on the fringe of a lower middle-class commercial district in downtown Fresno. It was a ramshackle storefront with an old dentist chair prominently displayed in the window. In the chair was a girl who couldn't have been more than 14 or 15. She sat with her skinny, pimpled neck bowed toward her lap. wincing with each needle puncture. On a tall stool beside her sat a young guy with a bright blue and yellow bandana wrapped tightly around his head. He was applying the tattoo. He reached for a bottle of ink. The array of tattoo inks beside him reminded me of the spin art booth at a school fair. I watched the tattoo process from the street for the next few minutes. I couldn't help thinking about the role of physical pain in getting tattoos, but also in the murders so far. I knew the basic tattoo process and watched as the resident artist adjusted a gooseneck lamp towards the nape of the girl's neck. The artist used 2-foot-operated tattoo machines, one for outlining, the other for shading and coloring. The round shader between the machines held 14 different needles. The more needles, the more colorful the flash. A middle-aged man with a crew cut was passing by on the street, and he paused just long enough to mutter, "That's nuts, and so are you for watching." Everybody's a critic these days. I finally went inside and saw the tattoo master's art, a small Celtic symbol, green and gold. I asked him where I could get fangs and claws. He moved his head, his chin actually, to indicate a hallway to his left. Never said a word. I walked past display cases, tongue and navel studs, including glow-in-the-dark studs, massive knuckle rings, sunglasses, pipes, beaded thingies, a poster for 2 popular claws, Ogre and Faust. "You're getting warmer," I thought, as I entered the hallway. And then I met the Fang Master, face to face. He was expecting me, and he just started talking as soon as I entered his small shop. "You finally arrived, Pilgrim. You know, when you go to the most interesting and most dangerous vampire clubs, the ones in L.A., New York, New Orleans, Houston, you see fangs everywhere. It's the scene, and what a scene, my man. Goth, Edwardian, Victorian, bondage apparel, anything goes. I was one of the first to custom make fangs out here. Started in Laguna Beach, worked my way north, now here I am, the Fresno Kid." As he spoke, I became aware of his teeth, his elongated incisors. Those teeth looked as if they could inflict severe damage. His name was John Barrero, and he was short, painfully thin, and dressed mostly in black, much like Peter Weston. He was probably the most sinister-looking person I'd ever met. "You know why I'm here. The Golden Gate Park murders?" I said to the Fang Maker. He nodded and grinned wickedly. "I know why you're here, Pilgrim. Peter Weston sent you. Peter's very persuasive, isn't he? Follow me." He took me into a small, overcrowded room in the rear of the store. The walls were dark blue, the lighting crimson. Barrero had a lot of nervous energy, and he moved around constantly as he spoke. "There is a fabulous fang club in Los Angeles. They like to say it's the only place where you can meet vampires and live to tell about it. On weekend nights, you might see 400 or 500 people there. Maybe 50 of the fuckers are real vampires. Almost everyone wears fangs, even the vampire wannabes."
"Are your teeth real?" I asked him.
"Let me give you a little nip and we'll see," the Fang Maker said and laughed. "The answer to your question is yes. I had my incisors capped, then filed to a sharp edge. I bite, I drink blood. I am the real deal bad dude, detective."
I nodded, didn't doubt it for a second. He looked and acted the part.
"If I might take a simple cast of your canines, I could make a pair of fangs just for you. That will really separate you from your detective peers, make you peerless."
I smiled at his wit, but I let him talk.
"I make several hundred sets of fangs every year, uppers and lowers, sometimes double fangs. Occasionally I make a pair in gold or silver. I think you'd look great with silver canines."
"You've read about the other killings around California?" I asked.
"I've heard about them, yes, of course. From friends and acquaintances like Peter Weston. Some vampires are excited by what's happened. They think it signals a new time. Perhaps a new sire is coming." I stopped him. A sudden chill ran through me. Something he'd just said. Is there a leader of the vampires? Barrero's dark eyes narrowed to slits.
"No, of course there isn't. But if there was, I wouldn't talk to you about it."
"Then there is a sire," I said. He glared at me and began to move about again. I asked, "Could you make tiger's teeth for a man to wear?"
I could, he said.